come from the Chronicles, 2 Chronicles chapter 20. This is familiar to you. You hear it. I just talked about it last Sunday. I think I prayed from it last Sunday, but I'm going to read these verses in your hearing. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verses 1 through 9. Verses 1 through 9. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verses 1 through 9. And I want to acknowledge some leaders in here today. Amen. Elder Johnny Elliott and Elder Edward Lee, they're here. And I want you all to just know they're here this praise morning with them. Yeah. That's right. Somebody's ready to clap their hands. Amen. Yeah. Read these verses of scripture to you when you hear it, verses 1 through 9, 2 Chronicles chapter 20. You got it, say amen.
Amen.
All right, everybody got it. All right. Now, you know, this is about Jehoshaphat and how he defeats these armies that's coming up against him, so many. It's about four or five. But the Lord gives him the power and strength because of the fact that he's not doing it himself. He didn't bring about a campaign where he could actually pull this off himself. He relied and trusted in the Lord. And plus, as you go into this text and you read this text, you will see how he followed the instructions of Jehazel, the prophet, the man of God. And when you follow the instructions, when you're headed in the right direction, when you're being obedient and you're being faithful, God will bless your life. God will not only bless your life, but he will show you that you're more than a conqueror, and he will give you victory even when your adversary is coming up to try to beat you down.
Yes, sir.
I wish I had some.
Yes, sir.
He will do it as long as you head in the right direction. Amen. I'm wondering this morning if you're headed in the right direction this morning. It's a new year. It's a new month. It's March. And it's March the 6th.
Yes, sir.
March the 6th, March the 7th. Something like that. What day is it? I don't even know what day it is. So I'm just glad to be in the land of the living. I'm glad to be above dirt. And so we're in a new month. You know, actually, this is the first Sunday of March.
Yes, it is.
Ain't that right?
First Sunday.
And so we thank God. And so let me read these words to you. This is about King Jehoshaphat. And this is a wonderful story. Sometimes, if you want to be encouraged, especially when you're down and out and seem like the whole world is crashing around you, whatever, you need to read this. Amen. You just pull this, read this. Because this is what I was reading when I was going through my divorce and when my grandson got murdered and when the church got broken into. I was in a whirlwind of, you know, all that stuff happened to me at one time. And the only reason why I stayed sane is because I was reading stuff like this.
Amen.
I just knew that God had my back and he was fighting my battles. I wish I had some praying
people. Amen.
I would read stuff like this. It would be the only thing that would encourage me and build me up. Keep me sane. Keep my focus on the Lord. So watch this. After this, starting in verse 1, 2 Chronicles 20, verse 1. After this, the Moabites and the Ammonites with some of the Mennonites came to make war on Jehoshaphat. This is war. Some men came and told Jehoshaphat, a vast army is coming against you from Edom, from the other side of the sea. Mm-hmm. It is already in Hazar Tamar, that is in Galilee. Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord. When he first heard the news, guess what? He didn't go to any of his people.
He
didn't go to anybody for advice.
Come on now.
He didn't go to, watch this, this is good. Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast for all Judah. He knew what to do in this situation. These armies are coming up against him. Right away, he said, we need to pray and fast.
Yes, sir. Amen.
We need to call on the Lord. So watch this. The people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. everybody assembled under the king because his direction was, let's go to the Lord.
Yeah.
I wonder how many of y'all are headed in the right direction this morning. I wonder how many of y'all consult the Lord, consulted him this morning.
Yeah.
About whatever you might be going through. Then Jehoshaphat stood up in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem at the temple of the Lord in front of the new courtyard and said these words. Watch this, because now he's crying out. O Lord God of our fathers, are you not the God who is in heaven? So he's acknowledging him. Mm-hmm. You are the only God. You are the creator. He says, are you not the God who is in heaven? Because see, he ain't seeking nobody in the flesh. He ain't seeking out nobody here on the earth. Watch this.
Amen.
You rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. So right there he says, you got rule over these armies that's getting ready to come up against you.
Yeah, yeah.
Watch this. He's putting it in God's hand. I love this thing. I love it. He says, power and might are in your hand.
Yes, sir.
And no one can withstand you.
Go ahead.
See, now he's calling on God and he's acknowledging God is that you are the battle axe.
You are the one.
Great God for that. That's going to protect us from these armies that's getting ready to come up against you. God, I'm calling on you.
Yes, sir. I'm
calling on you for your help. Because I can't get no help from nowhere else.
Yes, sir.
Watch this. It's good now. He's giving him all the glory and honor and praise. And he says, oh, our God, did you not drive out the inhabitants? He took him back.
Yes, sir.
He you know, because God ain't got to go back because he's eternity. So he don't have to go back in the past. But he reminded him. He reminded God. He says, did you not take out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel gave it? Before you gave it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend, he reminded him of the covenant that he made with Abraham.
Yes, sir.
Did you not promise God that you was going to take care of us? Didn't you tell Abraham you was going to take care of him?
Yes,
then you make a covenant with him? Now he reminded God of the promise
that
he made. I don't know about you this morning, but that's why I tell y'all going to learn the word, because there's about 3,000 to 4,000 promises in here, and all you got to do is hold on to one of them. I wish I had some praying people. Hold on to one word that God says, and watch what he'll do. In fact, listen, I love this kind of praying here, because he cried out. He says, they have lived in it and have built in a sanctuary for your name.
Yes,
now he's proclaiming who God is.
Yes, sir.
You are sovereign over everything. If calamity comes upon us, whether the sword of judgment, watch this, or plague or famine, we will stand in your presence before this temple that bears your name and will cry out to you in our distress, and you will hear us and you will save us. What kind of confidence is that? God Almighty, four armies are coming up against now. You see, four armies are coming up against them, and these vast armies are big. They're huge. They got all these weapons. This is Judah and Jerusalem. They don't have a lot of manpower and weapons and all that kind of stuff. Jehoshaphat went right to God.
Yes, he did.
Went right to God and reminded him, this is the direction I want to go in, Lord. I'm coming to you for some help.
Yes, sir.
If I could use for a subject matter today, it would be called the right direction. Are y'all headed in the right direction? Because Jehoshaphat caught him. He knew what to do in the time of trouble. He called on the Lord and reminded him, you was the one that wiped out these nations and brought us in this land that flows with milk and honey, and you gave it to us. Then you promised by your friend. I wish I had some friends. You promised by Abraham. You made a covenant that you would keep us.
Yes, sir.
Come on, wouldn't let no harm come to us. Do y'all know today that's why nobody can touch Israel? I wish I had some historians in here. I wish I had some people in here that inspired them. Do you know that, listen, people have been trying to come up against Israel and destroy it for over 800 years. They never will. Because God made a promise to Abraham. I'm going to keep you and protect you. Ain't nobody going to be able to take this land. Look, over in Assyria right now, they're trying to take Israel. Guess what? They won't win. Do y'all remember when Russia tried to come up against Israel? And Israel blew Russia. What? Set them with their tails hanging between their legs. I said Russia tried to come up against Israel a few years back. Israel blew them away. Get out of here.
Come on then, dog.
Because God said you can't touch this way.
Can't touch this.
See, he made a covenant. He made a promise with Abraham. Right. I'm going to bless your descendants.
Right.
And if y'all are saved and born again, guess what? We are the descendants of Abraham.
Abraham.
I wish I had some friends. That's why we are children of faith. Because we can call on the Lord just like Jehoshaphat did.
Yeah.
Some of y'all don't believe that. You can call on the Lord just like Jehoshaphat. In the time of trouble, you want to head up in the right direction. You want to make right choices and right decisions. Call on the Lord like Jehoshaphat. And do like Jehoshaphat did. Remind him. Lord, you remember your friend Abraham? You remember him? Lord, you made a covenant with him. And I'm a friend of Abraham.
That's
so didn't God say these words in his word? Didn't he say those who bless Israel, he will bless them? And those who curse Israel, he will curse them? See, America is walking on thin ice. I wish I had some friends. America's got to watch herself because America is getting ready to come up under the judgment if she don't back up Israel. I wish I had some friends people in here. I'm telling y'all right now, you need to be praying for Israel. You might say, well, Pastor, what is that doing if I pray for Israel? Pray for Israel. Because God will bless you for praying for Israel. I'm trying to drop something on you because he said, those who bless Israel, I will bless
you.
I wish I had some friends. He'll give me the rules in a minute. But he said he'll bless you.
Yes, sir.
Right. If you go against Israel, guess what? He's going to curse you. And it's in the Bible.
Right.
I believe every word of the Bible.
Amen.
Yes, I do.
Amen.
There was once a boxer who was being plummeted in the ring by his opponent. Blow after blow, his adversary left him with a bloody nose, swollen eyes, and an enormous amount of pain. The battered boxer's trainer, trying to encourage him between rounds, kept telling him, "You're doing great, Fred. That bum is barely touching you." To which the boxer responded by saying these words, "Then you better keep your eye on that referee because somebody is killing me in here." Because that boy was punishing him. But ain't it all right? Somebody try to encourage him. In the midst of your death. Yes, sir. No amount of smooth talk could camouflage the reality of the bloody battle in which this fighter was engaged. Psychologically, correct talk and personal encouragement could not match the pain he was suffering. In the same way, you and I are engaged in a real battle too. One of the cosmic proportion, and that is that every day that the Lord wake you up in the morning and lay you down to go to sleep, you're in a fight. I wish I had some friends in here. Y'all ain't got to believe in the supernatural if you don't want to. Keep having birthdays. Keep living. You will see that the devil is your enemy. The devil is your adversary. Not people. And he will use people that you love the most. And ain't in Christ. He'll use them to get you to battle. Because you're in a spiritual warfare. From the time you wake up until the time you go to sleep, you're in a battle. Every day for your life. I don't care how good your day went. And you say, hey, I had a blessed day, Pastor. I have no problem. You're still in a warfare. You're in a battle. God just protected you that day. God just gave you a blessed day. You just had a good day. That's all. You know, that's why I tell y'all there's good days and better days. There's no such thing as a bad day. Some of y'all will say that real quick. I had a bad day. Well, there ain't no such thing as a bad day. Because this is the day of the Lord. Let us rejoice and be glad.
Amen.
Why?
Amen.
Because the Lord is in the day.
Amen.
Bad stuff happens in the day.
Right.
But the day ain't bad.
Yeah.
Ain't nothing wrong with the day.
Yeah.
I wish I had some friends. Some of y'all are going to be real funny. Y'all are going to be like, Pastor, you just don't know what kind of day I had already. Well, I'll keep having birthdays.
Amen.
And they are getting better.
Amen.
You got good days and you got better days.
Amen.
Ain't no such thing as a bad day for a Christian. We're in this battle, real battle. Needing the right direction. Are you guys walking in the right direction? We know we are facing a real opponent because of the world that bears the bloody, painful scars of this conflict, war among nations, shattered lives, broken homes, suicide, rape, abuse of all kinds, and all types of immorality and of every unimaginable kind. You know, we got to kind of, you know, people are doing stuff. You know, this pastor just walked into the church last, this brother just walked into the church last week and shot and killed his brother because he thought the brother owed him some money from the church. He thought he was a gangster. He walked in the church and shot his brother, killed his brother. He said, "Where's my 50%? 50% of what? Just remember, you don't even get no tithes and offerings. You don't get nothing. What is you talking about? Where's your money?" He thought he must have had some kind of connection where, you know, but that was nothing but the devil.
That's right.
Walked in there, shot his brother, and killed him. Well-loved pastor, sound doctrine preaching pastor. They had a big funeral for him. You can pull it up on iTunes and all that other stuff like YouTube, iTunes, whatever it is. And y'all know I don't know the language. Don't laugh at me because that ain't funny. I just hold up. And you can pull it up and you can see well loved, well respected, everything. He goes in there and shoot and kill his brother, the pastor, and then sit down and put the gun on the table and wait for the police to come and get him. You know, there ain't nothing but the gun.
But the gun.
Straight up. Now his life is ruined and they look like twins. His life is ruined, it's gone. I said that to say this, you're in a battle every day. I don't care how good, because that pastor didn't know he was going away from here and not by the hand of his brother.
That's right.
Somebody he trusted, somebody he loved, walked in his office. He probably thought he was just going to come in there and sit down and have a conversation with him. He didn't know he was going to come in there and shoot him and kill him. So no matter how good your day is, I want you to know this morning that you're in a battle.
That's right.
And because guess what? If Satan can have your soul, guess what? That's what he's after. Every day. If you don't believe it, he's after your soul every day. And if he can get you, God Almighty, he feels like he's done something. If he can get you, he feels like he's done something. And at that point, he would have accomplished something, especially if you're sitting under the word and you ain't made your peace with God. I wait for the amen. Especially if you're hearing sound doctrine and you still have not pledged your allegiance to Christ. Something's wrong with that picture. That's why people are going away from here and you don't know why. But God uses things. He uses things in his perfect timing to wake us up and give us a wake-up call. Although it is easy for preachers to tell God's people, greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world, and we are more than conquerors through Christ, these statements often seem to fly in the face of life's day-to-day realities. Myriads of believers are troubled by questions such as, if God is so strong, why am I so weak? And if he gives us victory, why am I losing so many battles? I'm glad you asked that question. It is because God presses upon us that we can arrange life by our choices.
Amen.
I wish I had some prayer people in here. Do you know that every day that the Lord wake you up and give you your right mind, that you know, as these preachers say, you know, go after your destiny. You can kind of form your destiny by choices and decisions that you make every day. Don't believe the hype. Don't believe the hype. But listen, but he wants to press upon you to make the right choices. Move in the right direction. Never going to the left, but always going to the right.
Amen.
It's your life. You can live it the way you please. This is what television tells you. So the television commercials proclaim that you can do anything that you want to do. You can be anybody you want to be. So does television say. Time and chance happens to all of us. That's what television says. Just when you think you have something under control, it can all fall apart.
Come on now.
But with the right direction, you can go very far. In Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 through 7, it says these words, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on to your own understanding.
Yes, sir.
In all your ways, acknowledge him. And he will direct. All right, now I'm on the right path now. He will direct. He will direct your path straight. Be not wise in your own eyes, but fear the Lord and shine. Now, that's the right direction.
Amen.
That is the right direction to take. Watch this, because it gets better. The implications of this matter not going in the right direction has tremendous ramifications. It means, for instance, that many of the things we are doing to fix our broken and bruised lives are misplaced activities according to the flesh, which does not properly address the spiritual causes of our problems.
Amen.
I know y'all say, boy, that was a lot, Pastor. Read that again. Okay, I will. Thank you for asking me to read it again. Watch this. It means, for instance, that many of the things that we are doing to fix our broken and bruised lives are misplaced activities according to the flesh, which do not properly address the spiritual causes of our problems.
Amen.
That's what's going on.
Amen.
Y'all know we're doing a whole bunch of stuff and we just wasting time.
Amen.
Secondly, this also suggests that Satan's greatest, watch this, achievement is not necessity in the problems that he has caused.
Yeah.
See, because sometimes we get it twisted.
Yeah.
Man, we need this and we need that.
Yeah, yeah,
you know, God is the only one that knows exactly what you need. That's why Paul said in Philippians 4:19, he will supply all your needs because he knows what you need. Not what you want. Now, he'll give you some of that too. He'll give you some wants sometimes just to show you you don't need it. But Satan always throw necessities up in your face. He will always try to put something out there to distract you from who God really is.
Yeah.
Now, come on, y'all. Y'all know he does it all the time. When y'all see some new shoes or a new dress or new outfit or y'all see something new and it's just because you see it and it's new, you want it, that don't mean you need it.
Amen.
There's nothing wrong with having stuff, but learn how to be content with what you have.
That's right.
I've been wearing these shoes for about 10 years. I don't hold the heels out. Guess what? One of my favorite pair of shoes. Now, I got about 30 pairs of shoes, but guess what? I'll wear these out because guess what? I don't need the other ones.
All right.
This is my favorite pair. My feet feel good in these.
Yeah.
They might not look all the best there, I'm just saying, I don't have to go out and buy me no new shoes. I wait for the amen. All I got to do is take me a buffer. I got this little buffing pad. Throw on these janks, hit these janks a couple of times in the front, and you'll see that little shiny. I know these janks about 10 years old. I don't wore a hole in the front of them. You just can't see it. I don't let you see me walking in the front. I ain't got no holes in these, but I got some shoes with some holes in them. I'm just saying. Sometimes you just don't need to. Sometimes we just foolishly waste money. Because Satan will tell you, if you want it, go get it.
Just do it.
You can have it. Look what he told Jesus. Look at what he told him in the wilderness. You can have all of this if you bow down and worship me, knowing he created him. Oh, Lord, have mercy. He is something. He is something so crazy. You tell the Creator, if you bow down and worship me, I'll give you all these kingdoms. He's already the King of Kingdoms and the Lord of Lords. Watch when he come back. And watch and see, don't he rule over all the kingdoms. If you don't believe me, it's in here. When he got up from the grave, after 3 days of being dead, I feel my anointing now because I feel the anointing of the Holy Spirit. He got off the Bible and said, with all power. And said, all power and authority in his hands. He's got all power. And so the devil, you know, just looked like a fool. When he said that, if you bow down and worship me, I'll give you all these things. See, you know, this is the problem with us. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. And Satan uses that on all of us in here every day. He did it with Adam and Eve. You ain't got to believe him. He did it during the time of Abraham and Sarah. He did it with Noah. He did it with Samson. You know, Samson was a strong man of God. But when Delilah laid him down,
that's it.
Samson, after a while, he got weak and couldn't take it. Like, hey, girl, what you did to me now?
Amen.
It's in my hair. And when she cut his hair,
that was all over.
Until God restored him. It was all over. Because some people you just don't need around you.
Amen.
Some people, some things you just don't need to do.
That's right.
You need to be headed in the right direction. I'm almost finished, y'all. I'm moving right along. Watch this, because it gets better. This is how Satan works. It is rather in the perspective he has duped us into believing, this is Satan, namely, that we see, hear, taste, touch, and smell, is the real deal. But what we detect with our senses is merely the outworking on earth of unseen spiritual activity and conflict in heaven. That stuff that we see around us every day with the killing and murdering and all that kind of stuff like that, guess what? That stuff is coming out of the second heaven. Amen. If you don't believe me, read the book of Daniel. The book of Daniel said that Daniel prayed for 21 days. But his prayers didn't get answered like he thought they were. I guess he probably thought God was going to answer him right away. It took 21 days for Michael, the archangel, who is probably the general of the heavenly host, broke through so that Gabriel could break through, because Gabriel, when he got to him, I don't know if it was Gabriel or not, because God got so many angels, and we don't know their ranks, but we know that these are powerful angels, Gabriel and Michael. But anyway, if it was Gabriel that broke through and told him, told Daniel, God heard you praying the first day you cried. Yeah. He said, but there was a war going on in the cosmos. You need to, in the second heaven, there was a war going on. Every day, y'all can believe this or not, it's supernatural. There's a war going on in the second heaven every day. That's why you got all this evil in the earth, because you got good angels protecting us, and you got bad angels that send people doing all the foolish stuff. Okay, y'all, I know y'all looking at like, well, pastor, people just mean. No, people ain't just mean. Paul said in Ephesians, he said, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, principalities and powers, rulers of the darkness of this world, spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. No, it's evil spirits that get into people. Yeah. And make them do what they do.
Yeah.
I wish I had some brains. All right, y'all not believing. To miss this is to miss, watch this. To miss this is to miss dealing with what is really wrong. It is the wisdom of God that will lead you into fullness and liberty and inward peace in the midst of the pressures and the dangers of life. Jehoshaphat caught this. He knew it. He knew, instead of him trying to mount up his army, get all his generals and all his sergeants of arms and everybody together, and all his privates or whatever, and get this army together, he went straight to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords that already had punished these nations before they got there. He knew it. He caught it. He got it. Watch this. We know and learn that struggle, pain, pressure, and sorrow all are part of a learning process. Learn what? Know what? Glad you asked. Have a mind and heart for the right direction, as did King Jehoshaphat and the Israelites. In spite of their checkered past and their present plight, God will be true to his covenant promise. That's why he reminded him, you remember your friend Abraham? You remember him, God? If you remember him, then you're going to remember us, because we're a part of that covenant. There are two basic principles mutated in the Chronicles books that prevail throughout the Old Testament. Namely, obedience brings blessings, and disobedience brings judgment. In the Chronicles, when the king obeyed and trusted the Lord, God blessed and protected them. But when the king disobeyed or put his trust in something or someone other than the Lord, God withdrew his blessings and his protection. See, God is like this. You think you can handle it? You think you got it? Go ahead. Go ahead. I'm going to let you punish yourself. Because that's what we be doing. We be thinking people doing stuff to us, but you better look in the mirror. Mike said, the man in the mirror. You better look in the mirror. Sometimes it's you. You making wrong choices and wrong decisions, and God will withdraw himself. He'll still be around. You just won't get them blessings until you straighten up, learn something. There were three basic failures by the kings of Judah that brought God's wrath. Number one, it was personal sin because of false worship or idolatry. And number three, trusting in man rather than trusting in God.
Amen.
That's what happened in the Chronicles. But in Jehoshaphat's case, he stood in the redecorated center court, praying for the nation. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17, it says these words, pray without ceasing. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 6, it said these words, but in everything make your prayers known. Now, you entered into the right direction. The king also appealed to the promises. In Psalms 119, verse 57, these words are said, that the Lord is our portion and we are to hold on to his promises. In Romans chapter 9, verse 8, it says these words, that we are the children of his promise. That's why I tell y'all, don't worry about stuff, because God is going to see you through. Yes. He also appealed to the glory of God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, it says, we are to do all things to the glory of God. In Isaiah 40, verse 5, it says that God's glory will be revealed, and it is going to be revealed in the person of Jesus Christ. And so, the right direction, let me get ready to wind this down, points to who? Does it point to the pastor?
No.
Does it point to the deacons?
No.
Does it point to the elders?
No.
It points to Jesus.
That's right. Jesus.
Jesus is the right direction in everything that you ever stand in need of, that you need to know, that you need to do. You go to him first, and then you pursue.
That's
right. There's nothing wrong with you having dreams and ambitions. There's nothing wrong with you setting goals and having plans. But have you went to him first? Because that's the right direction.
That's right.
Amen. If you decide to go to the left or go south, guess what? He'll let you go left. He'll let you go south. And what you have to deal with is the consequences. I'm trying to help y'all this morning. In order for you to be blessed of God, if you really want his blessings poured out in your life, you're going to have to line up with him. Line up with him this morning, because tomorrow ain't promised to you. The Bible clearly tells you in Matthew 6, don't worry about the troubles of today. They got their own troubles. The troubles of the day has their own trouble.
Yes.
Don't worry about them.
Worry
about tomorrow.
That's right.
It's full of its own trouble.
Yes.
And so in the right direction, God is calling you to look at him. How many of y'all this morning are looking at him?
Amen.
How many of you are looking at him? How many of you look at him in your marriage?
Amen.
If your marriage is on the brinks or it's on the rocks, it's because you ain't looking at him. You know what? One of the things that I do now in marriage counseling is I tell the couple, make covenant with God and make God the center of your marriage. Because guess what? If you don't, it won't work. I'll wait for the amens of that name. It just won't work. And you probably be saying, well, Pastor, I know some couples that are married and they're not in Christ, they're not in church, and they seem like